The Audio Partners Publishing Corporation is pleased to present West with the Night by Beryl Markham, read by Julie Harris. This is complete and unabridged.
Chapter 1. Message from Nungwe. How is it possible to bring order out of memory? I should like to begin at the beginning, patiently, like a weaver at his loom. I should like to say, this is the place to start, there can be no other. But there are 100 places to start, for there are 100 names, Mwanza, Serengeti, Nungwe, Molo, Nakuru. There are easily 100 names, and I can begin best by choosing one of them, not because it is first, nor of any importance in a wildly adventurous sense, but because here it happens to be, turned uppermost in my logbook. After all, I am no weaver. Weavers create. This is remembrance, revisitation. And names are keys that open corridors no longer fresh in the mind, but nonetheless familiar in the heart. So the name shall be Nungwe. As good as any other, entered like this in the log, lending reality, if not order, to memory. Date, 16-6-35. Type aircraft, Avro Avian. Markings, VP, KAN. Journey, Nairobi to Nungwe. Time, 3 hours 40 minutes. After that comes pilot, self, and remarks, of which there were none. But there might have been. Nungwe may be dead and forgotten now. It was barely alive when I went there in 1935. It lay west and south of Nairobi, on the southernmost rim of Lake Victoria Nyanza, no more than a starveling outpost of grubby huts, and that only because a weary and discouraged prospector one day saw a speck of gold clinging to the mud on the heel of his boot. He lifted the speck with the tip of his hunting knife and stared at it until it grew in his imagination from a tiny rusty grain to a nugget and from a nugget to a fabulous steak. His name eludes the memory, but he was not a secretive man. In a little while, Nungwe, which had been no more than a word, was both a Mecca and a mirage, so that other adventurers like himself discounted the burning heat of the country, the malaria, the black water, the utter lack of communications, except by foot through forest trails, and went there with shovels and picks and quinine and tinned food and high hopes, and began to dig. I never knew what their digging got them, if it got them anything, because when I set my small biplane down on the narrow runway they had hacked out of the bush, it was night, and there were fires of oil-soaked rags burning in bent chunks of tin to guide my landing. There's not much to be seen in light like that. Some dark, upturned faces, impassive and patient, half-raised arms beckoning, the shadow of a dog slouching between the flares. I remember these things, and the men who greeted me at Nungwe, but I took off again after dawn without learning anything about the success of their operations or the wealth of their mine. It wasn't that they meant to keep those things concealed, it was just that they had other things to think about that night, and none of them had to do with gold. I had been working out of Nairobi as a freelance pilot with the Muthaiga Country Club as my headquarters. Even in 1935, it wasn't easy to get a plane in East Africa, and it was almost impossible to get very far across country without one. There were roads, of course, leading in a dozen directions out of Nairobi. They started out boldly enough, but grew narrow and rough after a few miles, and dwindled into the rock-studded hills, or lost themselves in a morass of red muram mud or black cotton soil in the flat country in the valleys. On a map they looked sturdy and incapable of deceit, but to have ventured from Nairobi south toward Machakos or Magadi in anything less formidable than a moderately powered John Deere tractor was optimistic to the point of sheer whimsy. And the road to the Anglo-Egyptian Sudan, north and west through Naivasha, called practicable in the dry season, had, when I last used it after a mild rain, an adhesive quality equal to that of the most prized black treacle. This minor defect, coupled with the fact that thousands of miles of papyrus swamp and deep desert lie between Naivasha and Khartoum, had been almost flippantly overlooked by a government road commission, which had caused the erection, near Naivasha, of an impressive and beautiful signpost reading, "To Juba."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.